Hello again. We're going to continue with stories from the Lakota way. This one is about honor. It means to have integrity, to have an honest and upright character. This is the story of the snake. The old ones like to say that there are many strange and mysterious things in the world. They knew this to be true because they had seen things, some wondrous, some funny, some powerful or small. But everything has a purpose, they said. Everything that happens is a gift from life itself, if for nothing else than to teach us a lesson. My grandfather told me about some hunters long ago who met something powerful and mysterious and learned a lesson about honor, a lesson they would remember each time they saw a snake. Four hunters went into the great mountains we call Pahasapa, the Black Hills, whose pine-covered slopes look black from a distance. These mountains are important to us because they are so mysterious and powerful, and because the old ones say we came up out of the earth through a hole in the ground there, a cave. Today it is called Wind Cave. Hunting was always good in the Black Hills because elk and deer were always plentiful. After a day's travel into the mountains, the hunters made camp in a secluded, narrow meadow. There they prepared their weapons and rested. They fell asleep that night, eager for the new day and for good things to happen. Sometime in the night, one of them woke to add wood to the fire and saw a frightening and terrible sight. A giant snake had encircled them at their camp. The hunter was frightened. He closed his eyes and opened them, but the snake was still there. He woke the others, motioning them to keep silent, and pointed at the snake. None of them had ever seen such a thing. It seemed as though they were all having the same bad dream, and all they could do was huddle together in confusion. As yet, the snake had not moved. "What shall we do?" the youngest of them whispered. "Perhaps we can kill it with arrows if we all shoot at once." "No," cautioned the oldest. "We cannot kill it. It will kill us. It has to be very powerful. We must think of a way to escape while it seems to be asleep." They stood around the dying fire, but the moonlight through the large pines was bright, and they could see red and black stripes on the snake. They waited, each of them expecting the thing to disappear, because nothing in their lives had prepared them to believe that giant snakes were real. But it didn't disappear, so they had to believe that it was real. "We must do something," one of them said. "If it is asleep, it will certainly eat us when it awakens. It could swallow us all easily." Without a doubt it could. Its back was as high as the hump of a buffalo, and was as long as 20 buffaloes standing in a circle, nose to tail. "There is only one thing to do," the oldest hunter told them. "We must jump over it." All of them are strong and healthy, but none of them had ever had to jump over a giant snake. "We can dig a hole, get in, and cover ourselves," suggested another. "Perhaps it will think we have escaped and leave." "The ground is full of stones," said the oldest. "We have no tools to dig such a large hole. We must jump before it wakes." The others yielded to that logic, though not without some misgivings. Clearly, the one place to jump over was where the snake's head and tail came together, because it was the lowest spot. "First, we must throw our bows and arrows over," said the oldest hunter, who was the leader. "I will go last, and you must be first," he said to the youngest. "Take a run and leap over the spot where the head and tail are."
"I cannot," whined the young man. "If I cannot jump high enough, or if I fall..."
"It is more than likely certain that the snake is here to eat us," said the leader. "So you must try." He tossed his weapons a good distance to the trees over the snake's back, as did the others. But the youngest was too frightened to jump, so the leader pointed to the next man. "Go, take a run and jump." The man stepped back just beyond the fire as the others moved aside to give him room. Suddenly he dashed forward and jumped, tumbling over the snake's head and into the brush beyond. He landed with a thud and stood, motioning for the others to follow. Encouraged, the next man did likewise, crashing through the brush at the edge of the trees behind the snake. The leader grabbed the youngest hunter by the shoulder. "See," he said, "it can be done. They have jumped, and you can too." The young man took deep breaths. "Yes," he said uncertainly, "I will try." Then he stepped beyond the fire, tried not to look at the snake, and ran as hard as he could. He might have made it. His fear had helped him jump so high that he would have cleared the snake's back. But he didn't, because the snake raised his head and sent the young man crashing back to the ground near the fire. He landed so hard that he was knocked out. The two hunters who had already jumped ran and hid in the trees. The leader quickly bent over the unconscious young hunter as the snake raised its terrible head and stared at them with unblinking eyes. There was nothing to be done. The two hunters were at the mercy of something they didn't know existed until that night. Frightened down to the core of his very being, the leader could do nothing but wait. What might happen? After a long wait, all the while chilled by the unblinking black eyes of the giant snake, he felt the young man stir. Strangely, the snake moved at the same time, crawling off into the dark forest, silently moving through the trees in spite of its size. When it was gone, the other hunters came out of hiding. The youngest one woke and grabbed his head. "I have a terrible headache," he said. "The snake spoke to me in my head." The other two hunters gathered their weapons and strung their bows. "It might come back," one of them says. "If it does, we must fight it." "No," said the youngest. "It will not come back."
"What do you mean?" asked the leader.
"The snake talked to me inside my head," said the youngest. "It has asked us to do something for him. If we do not, he will find us and swallow us." The others thought for a moment. Perhaps there was something to what the young one was saying. After all, before tonight, none of them would have believed that such a thing as a giant snake was real. So that same giant snake talking to the young man in his head was not difficult to believe. "What did the snake tell you?" asked one. "We must make a journey north by east," he told them, "until we have come to a flat river and follow it into a low valley. There we will find a single lodge with a red door. The man lives there with his wife and child, a man with a scar under his eye. He will be expecting us. Two of us must wait with the wife and child while the other two take the man north, keeping north by east across the great muddy river, and until they find a long, narrow lake that is not deep. The man must walk across that lake. The snake said if he crosses to the other side, he will be free to return home."
"If he does not cross to the other side, what will happen?" the leader asked.
"I do not know," replied the young man. "I know only what the man must walk into that lake and try to reach the other side. Whatever happens, we must return to his lodge." They stayed awake the rest of the night, afraid that the snake would return. But it didn't. In the morning they traveled east, and by sundown they were out of the mountains. The following sunrise they headed north by east, and 2 days later they came to a river and camped.
"Are you certain the snake talked to you?" asked one of the hunters. "Could it be that you thought he did? Perhaps it was only a dream."
"Was the snake a dream?" asked the leader. "I've never heard of such a thing, yet I saw it. I am to think my eyes and my ears are lying to me?"
"I'm only trying to be certain that we are not being led into a dangerous thing," replied the first hunter.
"Or made to look like fools. I, for one, think that traveling into country we don't know, perhaps even into enemy country, because we listened to someone who said a snake talked to him, is laughable."
"I have not lied," insisted the youngest hunter. "I told you what I heard. The snake said if we do not do as he says, he will take us all, he will swallow us."
"You are free to go," the leader said to the first hunter. "You do not have to believe what this young man says, but remember, we all saw the snake. We all saw what happened to this young man. So I believe him because I don't want a giant snake following me, waiting to swallow me."
"If we find the lone lodge with the red door," retorted the first hunter, "then we will know that this is all true.
If we do not find such a lodge or a man with a scar below his eye, I will go home, back to do something sensible. The next day, after following the river for half a day, they came to a valley. Not too far into the valley, they came upon a lodge in a grove of trees. The lone lodge had a red door. In it lived a man with a young wife and child. The man had a scar under one eye. The hunters were more surprised to see him than he was to see them, as if he knew they were coming. The man was past middle age, with streaks of gray in his hair, and his wife was very young. He showed them a good spot along the river for their camp, and lingered to talk. "My wife will have food for you. You must come to my lodge and eat. You have traveled far, and I knew that you would come some day," he told them. "I know also that you have something to tell me." The hunters were reluctant, but they had been given a task, so the leader revealed the purpose of their journey. "Two of us are to remain with your wife and child, while two take you north by east, across the great muddy river, and onto a long, shallow lake. It is many, many days' journey, perhaps as much as one moon. When we reach that lake, you are to walk across. If you reach the other shore, you can come home." "Yes," said the man with the scar under his eye, "I will travel with you. We can leave 2 days from now. I wish to have one more day with my wife and son before I must leave. When you have made your camp, come to our lodge and eat." First a giant snake, now a mysterious man with a scar. The hunters didn't know what to think. For certain they had been drawn into something they knew nothing about, and a long, long journey into unknown territory awaited them. "Why must he walk across the lake?" asked one of the hunters as they made camp. "Why does he live here with only his wife and child?" asked the second hunter. "Was he banished from a village? Only people who are banished live alone." "If he is banished, what did he do?" wondered the leader. "It is more than likely something very bad. A man is not banished for something minor." The evening meal of elk stew, prepared and served by the man's young wife, was very good. She was courteous and very shy. Her baby was just now walking and stayed close to his mother after the strangers entered his home. The four hunters were polite guests and very grateful for a woman's cooking. The talk around the fire was about hunting and about the good late summer weather. Nothing was said about the arrival of the hunters or the news they brought. The evening passed pleasantly, and soon the hunters excused themselves, not wanting to overstay the hospitality of the cozy lodge. They spent the next day resting and making arrows. The leader decided that he and the youngest hunter should accompany the man north, a decision not disputed by the other two. Much of their talk was about the man and the scar under his eye, who as yet offered no explanation for his situation. They sensed that he was a good man, but they also saw a quiet sadness about him. That evening he came to their camp. "My wife knows I must make this journey with you," he said. "She wants to accompany me. We have not been apart since we became husband and wife. It is hard for her, this thing that I must do, but she will wait, as she knows she must." "These two will stay," said the leader, pointing to two of his companions. Indicating the remaining hunter, he said, "He and I will travel with you because the snake talked to him, and because when I was a younger man I traveled into that north country. It is the home of our enemies, so we must be careful." "I too went north as a young man," said the man with the scar. "I crossed the Great Muddy, but it was in winter. I shall be ready at dawn, and we will go." Once again, the man had not given an explanation. "You must be cautious," advised one of the hunters who was staying. "You will be in enemy country, but more than that, there is something about this that we don't know. It is not good to be blind about anything." At dawn, the three men departed. The young wife stood at the door of her lodge and watched until she could no longer see the travelers.
10 days brought them to the great muddy river. It was late summer, and the powerful river was low, though it still took all of their strength to cling to a log and swim with it across to the other shore. After several more days, they were into enemy territory. A flat, wide-open prairie country can make wanderers out of any being, whether it walks, crawls, or flies. The openness, one low hill after another, beckons. The top of one hill lures one to the next to see what is beyond. The three travelers saw great herds of the white-bellied goats, the antelope, and even greater herds of buffalo that covered the land like a great brown cloud. Above them soared the hawks and eagles and buzzards and ravens. If not for the uncertainty that awaited them at the end of their journey, the joy they felt at being part of the earth would not seem so out of place. Around the evening campfires, the man with the scar had talked easily but revealed little of himself, nothing at all to point to the reason for this strange journey. As yet he had said nothing of the snake, nor did he ask a question. The only certainty, as the snake had said, was that the man had been expecting the hunters to come to his lodge, and every night he had gone off a distance from the camp to smoke his pipe and pray. In enemy country, they traveled more slowly, keeping out of sight in the valleys. 15 days after crossing the great muddy river, they came to a long lake that curved much like a new moon. Though they had passed by several lakes, big and small, they knew this lake was the one. There was something here. The hunters could sense it. There were no animals and no birds in the sky or near the water. There was only a strange silence. Since entering enemy country, they had made few fires, and now they made a cold camp in a hidden cove at the water's edge. The two hunters were watchful for enemies, yet they knew somehow that none would come. "There is something about this place," said the leader. "There is a feeling here." "Yes," said the young hunter, "the same feeling when I first saw the snake." The man with the scar had spoken not at all since they had found the lake. That evening he went off alone. In a while they could hear him singing his death song. As the moon rose, he returned and spoke to his companions. "Tomorrow, after sunrise, I will walk into the lake as you told me I must do. I think I know what awaits me in the water. If I do not reach the other shore, take my things home to my wife. Be so kind as to see her back to her family. She has been away from them for too long. Ask her also what you want to know about me. She will tell you." So saying, he went away to sit near the water and await the dawn. Two hunters were certain of one thing. The man with the scar on his face was brave. Dawn came and turned into a pale red glow over the east horizon, and the waters of the lake shimmered with the same pale glow. Soon the sun rose over the edge of the earth. The hunters watched as the man with the scar removed his shirt and leggings, standing only in his breech clout and moccasins. Singing his death song and without looking back, he entered the water. There was no wind. The lake was calm and flat, as though frozen. A strange silence filled the air as the man walked farther and farther into the lake. It was shallow. Even as he drew near the middle of the water, it reached only to his thigh. The hunter stood on the shore and watched, hoping and praying that the man would reach the other shore. The width of the lake was more than an arrow could fly from a strong bow, but they could see the other shore. When the man reached the middle, the water rose to his chest. It was then that something happened to him. There was motion. The water began to move, as if boiling. Something dark broke the surface for just a heartbeat. Then the man with the scar on his face was taken under. The hunters ran up and down the shoreline as the waters of the lake once more became calm and flat. It was as if nothing had happened. They knew in their hearts that the man was gone, but they waited, hoping.
The morning passed. There was nothing, only the strange silence. Sadly, they gathered up his shirt and leggings, his bow and arrows, and his lance, and they began their journey home. 20 days passed before they returned to the lodge with the red door standing in the valley of the Flat River. The two waiting hunters were happy for their return. Some time ago, many days, one said, she began to weep and gashed her arms in mourning and cut her hair, and since she has worn ashes on her face. She knows something, said the leader. She knows her husband is gone. He did not reach the other shore of that lake. Something pulled him under. The youngest hunter gave the man's belongings to his mourning wife. She took them and thanked him for taking the journey with her husband. They waited for days out of respect for her state of mourning, making sure that she had food and water. One day she finally spoke to them. I must return to my village, she said.
We will take you there. Your husband asked us to do so, and we will, said the leader.
They traveled south by east, and the young widow spoke not at all, though she cooked for them and would help set up their night camps. She kept her thoughts to herself. After 15 days, they came to a large encampment just west of the Great Muddy River, north of where the Bad River flows into it. She was welcomed home by her family. The hunters were invited to stay as long as they chose, but they were anxious to return to their homes. They did stay to rest for a few days. On the evening before they were to leave, the young widow came to the hunters' camp. I must tell you of my husband, she said. When he was a young man, he had a good friend who became a powerful medicine man. But he turned to the darker side of the powers he had and became a helper for some bad spirits. My husband turned away from him, and in time he became a great warrior and a leader to whom the people turned. The medicine man was jealous of that and used his powers against my husband. He used a special medicine to take my husband's first wife away from him. Even then my husband would not give in, and the medicine man was shamed in front of the people. He went crazy and died that way. A spirit, a bad spirit, came to my husband. He said there was to be a punishment, but that my husband had to choose. He could take the shame of banishment, or he could watch his own village go crazy like the medicine man did. My husband chose the banishment. The spirit told him that one day 4 men would come for him, but that he would never know when. The spirit wanted my husband to think that every day was his last. He had one other choice. My husband could lift the punishment from himself whenever he wanted, but it meant his whole village would go crazy. How was it that you became his wife? The youngest hunter asked. My father sent me to him, she replied. He told me the story of this brave and honorable man, and said that his kind of honor and bravery must not die with him. It must be passed on, and so it has, because I have his child. The hunters returned to their own village. When their relatives asked why they had been gone away for so long, they would only reply that they had lost their way and made a long journey. But in time they told the story of that long journey. Some of the people believed it, some did not. Yet over time it was noticed that the 4 hunters who shared the journey were the humblest and most honorable men in the village. Perhaps it is not difficult to believe in giant snakes, but I have lived long enough to know that there is much I don't know. I can't say for certain that giant snakes don't exist, because I've seen many things in my life that may seem unbelievable to some, or just normal to others, like a man walking on the moon. But I do know for certain that there are many wondrous, powerful, and mysterious things we may experience in our lives. I hope one of them is honor.
Thank you for listening.